Here we go. I'm so glad to see you. I hope you're glad to see me, but it doesn't really matter whether you're glad to see me or not. The important thing is that we can say, as the psalmist said, I was glad when they said to me, let's go into the house of the Lord. So you might not be glad to see me, but you should be glad to be in the house of the Lord this morning. In fact, our singing this morning are going to be songs of joy. So if you haven't discovered some joy this morning, we hope before we leave this morning that your heart, your soul will be filled with joy. The scripture is replete with references and encouragement to rejoice and to be glad. And all the way from the Old Testament to the New Testament, the Apostle Paul said, rejoice. Again, I will say, rejoice, people. And then Jesus said, no, I have come and I have spoken to the world that they might receive my joy in themselves. Jesus was full of joy, and he wanted his followers to follow him with joy in their hearts. The psalmist says in the Old Testament that in the presence of the Lord, there is joy. So if we have gathered in the presence of the Lord, we can be sure that our hearts are right and in tune and are worshiping him, that in return, in his presence, there will be joy. And so we pray this morning that there will be rejoicing in the house of the Lord. So can you get a smile on your face and look like you're glad to be here this morning? We're going to sing our opening song, and in the middle, we're going to give you a chance to fellowship, to find somebody, smile at them real big and tell them, oh, I'm so glad to see you this morning, and I hope that you will be encouraged as you receive that word this morning of someone saying that they're glad to see you and welcome you into the house of the Lord. Okay, can you do that? We'll sing through one time, and then you'll have a fellowship time, and then we'll sing it again. So stand with us as we sing our opening song, He Has Made Me Glad, I Will Rejoice, for He Has Made Me Glad. Here we go. 1, 2, 3, 4.
I will enter his gates with thanksgiving in my heart. I will enter his courts with praise. I will say this is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice for he has made me glad. He has made me glad. He has made me glad. I will rejoice for he has made me glad. He has made me glad. He has made me glad. I will rejoice for he has made me glad.
Now turn around, find somebody, smile real big, tell them you're glad to see them this morning. Everybody sing.
I will enter his gates with thanksgiving in my heart. I will enter his courts with praise. I will say this is the day that the Lord hath made. I will rejoice for he has made me glad.
He has made me glad.
He has made me glad. He has made me glad. I will rejoice for he has made me glad. Make me glad.
Amen. Good singing. Praise the Lord this morning that He is with us. All right. Thank you. You may be seated.
Well, amen. That is good singing. The Lord makes us glad. We talk about, you know, we used to sing that little chorus, "The joy of the Lord is my strength." And we always talk about, do we do that?
Yeah, we're going to sing that this morning.
We're going to sing that this morning. Great minds think alike, or insanity runs, or whatever, and so whichever what direction it goes in. But we always like to talk about what it means to have joy over against happiness. You know, sometimes people say, "Are you happy?" And as a Christian, you say, "Well, I'm filled with the joy of the Lord," because happiness is based on happenings. That's the same word, is happenings. And so many of the things that happen in life, are they joyful? No, they're really not. But have you ever known somebody that just through that has this this joy that's not based on happiness, on happenings? It comes from knowing Jesus as your Lord and Savior, knowing that we can trust Him for this lifetime and for the life to come. And it gives great joy. I pray that you have that joy today, that you've experienced that joy and are experiencing that joy. I'm glad that you're here if you're a guest visiting with us. I met a guest this morning, too, and so we welcome you to our church today. There is a visitor's card. It's on the back of our bulletin. If you have a time at some point in time during the service to fill that out, you can leave that where you are seated or put it in one of the offering boxes in the foyers or back by the elevator. We'll have a record of your visit, and we'll pray for you this week. We'll remember you in our prayers. I want to welcome all the folks on Facebook this morning. We had almost 450 views of our worship service from last Sunday. We always have between 65 and 100 people that worship with us live through this streaming event, so we welcome them. Let's welcome the Facebook folks. Everybody here, we're glad. I was out running errands the other day, and somebody caught me in town, and they said, "I didn't think you were going to be there Sunday." They said, "Did we get? You know, we heard that there was a guest speaker, and then when I was watching on Facebook, out you walked onto the podium here, and so that blesses my heart when we hear of people that maybe we're helping them worship when otherwise they wouldn't have that opportunity. As long as that's the case, we'll provide this ministry gladly. Welcome to worship. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your love. God, thank you for this gathering. Thank you for those who gather with us on Facebook. Father, some who are out of state, some members who are traveling, some who are shut in, some who cannot make it to church for transportation or other reasons, God, may you add your richest and choicest blessings to those here and those who are hearing this and seeing this on Facebook. Father, thank you for your love. Thank you for the joy that comes from worshiping you, Father, that transcends happiness and happenings. And God, I pray, if there's anybody here today that's not experienced that joy, the joy of Jesus, that today, this day, they'll come to know Christ as their Savior, Lord, I pray in Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Thank you. Amen.
Amen and amen. Okay, to that. Thank you, Pastor. Nehemiah 8:10 says, "Do not sorrow, for the joy of the Lord is your strength." And it is our strength as Christians, no matter, as we've said, no matter what circumstances come our way, we have joy, and that gives us strength in the Lord. So we're going to get to that chorus in just a second, but first we're going to sing, "I'm so glad that Jesus lifted me, and since Jesus came into my heart, floods of joy like the sea billows rose since Jesus came into my heart." So let's stand and sing from our hearts this morning. "I'm so glad Jesus lifted me."
I'm so glad Jesus lifted me. I'm so glad Jesus lifted me. I'm so glad Jesus lifted me. Singing glory I was sinking down, Jesus lifted me, singing glory, hallelujah. Jesus lifted me, Satan had me bound, Jesus set me free. Satan had me bound, Jesus lifted me, Satan had me bound, Jesus lifted me, singing glory, hallelujah. Jesus lifted me.
I'm so glad.
I'm so glad Jesus lifted me. I'm so glad Jesus lifted me. I'm so glad Jesus lifted me. Singing glory, hallelujah. Jesus lifted me. The joy of the Lord is my strength. The joy of the Lord.
get it personal, first person, saying this is the day I will rejoice. Here we go.
This is the day, this is the day that the Lord hath made, that the Lord can
I will rejoice. I trust you will. Thank you. You may be seated. I think it's interesting that in the Old Testament, as the Lord God was giving instruction to the Israelites how to observe their final feast of the sacred year, which is called in Scripture the Feast of Tabernacles. And of course, it was when they built these temporary booths outside their homes to live in for a full week, as they observed and memorialized and celebrated how God had led them through the wilderness to the promised land and the wilderness. So as God was given the instructions for the observance of this feast, the Lord God concluded by saying, "And this commandment that I give to you, that you rejoice for these 7 days." So for 7 days, rejoice no matter what happened. God said, "No, you're going to rejoice." And so I hope this morning that we have that joy. God expects rejoicing when we come in his presence and think about all the things that we have that come from his hand. He's a good God. He's a faithful God. We have so much to be thankful for. I'm so looking forward to November when we turn our hearts and our direction toward praise and thanksgiving as we enter into the Thanksgiving season. But that's coming up. The scripture says that song we just sang, that chorus, is based on that verse of scripture found in Psalm 118 that says those exact words: "This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it." That song's been around a long time. One the praise team is going to sing for us this morning is another song based on that scripture, but we haven't sung it in our church, so this will be kind of our introduction to you of another great song based on that scripture verse. "Today is the Day" is written by Lincoln Brewster and Paul Belosi. We're going to sing it for you. It's a happy song. Here we go.
Today is the day. I'm trusting in what you say. Today is the day. Today is the day. Today is the day you have made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. Today is the day you have made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. And I won't worry about tomorrow. I'm giving you my fears and sorrows. Where you lead me, I will follow. I'm trusting in what you say. Today is the day. Today is the day. Today is the day. Today is the day. Today is the day.
Today is the day. We will rejoice and be glad in it. Amen. Thank you, guys.
Well, amen. Thank you, Brother Bob, and our worship leader and our worship leaders, because they all take part in leading us in worship on Sunday morning and do such a wonderful job sharing the message, the gospel message in song. As I've said many times before, I'm not the best preacher of the gospel, but I preach the best gospel because I preach Christ crucified, as Paul said. And we share together, and I appreciate worship leaders and those who, to me, are the best, but who also say what you're going to get on Sunday morning is the pure message of salvation through faith in Jesus Christ, and that means the world to me. That I haven't always had that joy of being with worship leaders that did that or presented that in that way. We've been blessed here at our church with those men, first with Brother Robert. And by the way, I don't know if he's watching this morning. He always texts me during University of Memphis football games. And I hope he is watching. When I'm going to say this, I always try to act like I'm interested. And so he and I have gotten to be even closer in these past 2 or 3 years than we were before. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your love. Thank you, Father, for your word. Thank you for your inerrant, infallible, holy word. And Father, we know that when you send forth your word, it does not return to you without accomplishing that which you will for it to accomplish. And God, that's my prayer right now, that as we share this message, and as it goes forth into this room, and it goes forth across the county, the state, and the country, or wherever through Facebook, God, that it will accomplish your purpose this morning. We pray, I pray, and we as Christians pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Let you take your Bible and open it to Luke chapter 15, the 15th chapter of Luke's gospel, where we have been now. These past several weeks, we were interrupted with Harvest Day, and that was a really good interruption, wasn't it? Dr. Sean Parker sharing God's word with us. What a wonderful man of God. I didn't know who could possibly replace Jim Futrell. That was a tough act to follow, but God sent us a wonderful executive director, treasurers for the Mississippi Baptist Convention Board. And thank you for your faithfulness. We met our goal last week that we had of $14,000 for new flooring in our education building. That has been ordered, and we're going to get some painting done before that takes place. And we just continue to want to better our worship center and our education space and our recreation space for His glory and His honor. And we're excited about what God is doing within the walls of this church and then without outside the walls of the church. Siblings often disagree, argue, and occasionally get into fights. Now, I know, looking out at this astute crowd of people here today, that you never got into an argument with your brother or sister. If you're an only child, you can proudly say, I've never gotten an argument with my brother or sister. And for the rest of us, we probably did at some point in time, didn't we? It's part of living under the same roof, living close proximity to each other, and that kind of happens. Hopefully, that dissipates when we get older. That's not always the case. It always burdens me, breaks my heart to see people that are grown that say, I have siblings that I refuse to talk to. I have someone that I just refuse to have anything to do with. That's always sad. I read a story about a sister that said, when I was growing up, my younger sister just bugged me, just bothered me to no end. And this grown woman said, one of the things my sister did that she knew would annoy me is every time that our parents would take us out to eat in a restaurant, she would order the exact same thing I ordered. She said, once we were in a cafe or a restaurant somewhere, and when the waitress came by, I insisted that she order first. So she ordered, and then after I placed my order, she said, she called the waitress and said, I changed my mind. I want what she's having. And one day when the sisters were grown, they were adults, she asked her younger sister, she said, you know, we used to fight like cats and dogs. Why did you always order? You did that just to bug me, didn't you? And that younger sister said, no. She said, I never told you this, but I wanted to be just like you. And she said, I felt as if I ate the same thing that you ate, I'd turn out just like you. I ate the same thing as my brothers, and we didn't turn out the same, I can tell you that. Good, bad, and indifferent. We're all different. Maturity often brings siblings together. Sometimes it doesn't. Today, we're going to finish our sermon series, Restoration, God's Lost and Found. And remember that series we started a few weeks back. Jesus tells three parables, and he's speaking to these Hebrew religious leaders back at the first of the chapter. Look at what's happening here. Back in Luke chapter 15 and verse 1. Now, the tax collectors and, quote, sinners, it is in my NIV, were all gathering around to hear him. But the Pharisees and teachers of the law muttered. We always say it's not good when people mutter, is it? It's not good. The Pharisees and teachers of the law muttered, this man welcomes sinners and eats with them. He is letting all of these sinners, and folks, when you read the word sinners, you can fill that in any way you want. Prostitutes, people that had broken the law before, people that were outcasts from their family for whatever the reason were, those tax collectors were hated, and so were those sinners by this ruling class of people that looked down at everybody. And Jesus tells these three parables. He tells a parable about a runaway sheep. Remember, the shepherd had 100 sheep. One of them ran away, and the shepherd went and searched for him until he found him. And it says he left the comfort and security of the stable, and he went out into the wilderness looking for the sheep. And we said we see that God sees individuals. You know, when he looks today at this room of people, he doesn't just see a crowd of people. He sees you, and he sees me. Then we talked about the rollaway coin. Jesus told that parable about the rollaway coin. We said the environment probably had a lot to do with where the coin went, how far it rolled away. And we said our environment a lot of times either keeps us close to the Lord or it tends to do what? Push us away from Him. Who do we hang out with? What do we surround ourselves with in life? It has an effect on us, doesn't it? And a couple of weeks ago, we talked about the parable of the resilient father. That was the prodigal son. And remember, we talked about the Hebrew word kasaza. That Hebrew Yiddish word kasaza. And kasaza was a ritual by which a village would say, if a Hebrew man rebels against his family and goes out and squanders all of his money, especially giving it to Gentiles, he can never come back in this town again. This town disowns him. And so that's why every day the father was doing this. He was looking for the prodigal son to come home. And when he saw him coming home, he ran out to meet him. And, you know, you probably get that image of it. He probably had that cloak on, and he looked back at the village, and he wrapped that son up in that cloak and brought him back in. And when he said, put a robe on him, it was sort of like a uniform that represented a family of importance. He said, put the uniform on him, that cloak on him, and put the ring on his finger, that signet ring that indicated power and authority, and shoes on his feet. He wasn't a servant. He was my son. He is my son, and my sons do not go barefoot. And so that kasaza was overcome by the love of that father. And despite the totally heartless, selfish request of the son, remember what the son said? Dad, I wish you'd die. I wish, what would you do to your son if he came up to you or your daughter and said that to you? And you imagine how broken that was. Despite all that, the father's love and compassion was unwavering. And today, the final scene, the final act in this drama, in this word painting that Jesus is painting toward the hypocrisy of those those men mentioned in verses 1 and 2. You see, this poor dad was not finished with suffering. He had another son that was going to take his turn in hurting his father. And it was another heartless, selfish deed. And understand, who is the central figure in all three of these parables that Jesus tells? God the Father is the central figure. He's the shepherd who went out looking for the sheep. He is represented through the woman who looked for the coin that was lost. And certainly He is the Father who welcomes us, all of us prodigals, back into His presence. And as far as forgiving his little brother and welcoming his home, the older brother was the reluctant brother. Have you ever been reluctant in forgiving somebody? Have you ever said something like this, I'll forgive you, but I'll never forget this? Have you forgiven them? No, you hadn't. And so notice what happens here in verse 25. So the prodigal sons come home, they've killed the fattened calf, they're having this big celebration. Meanwhile, the older son was in the field. When he came near the house, he heard music and dancing. So he called one of the servants and asked him what was going on. Your brother has come, he replied, and your father has killed the fattened calf because he has him back safe and sound. They're having this big barbecue, probably catered by Clancy's restaurant, conveniently located in, is that how you want me to say it? That's okay. And then verse 28, the older brother became angry and he refused to go in. Notice the dad. So the father went out and pleaded with him. Can you see how heartbroken this man is? But he answered his father, look, all these years I've been slaving for you and never disobeyed your orders. Yet you never gave me a young goat so I could celebrate with my friends. You have the prize calf from the herd for this rebellious prodigal, and you didn't even cook me a goat. How many of you, anybody ever eaten goat? Be honest, you've eaten goat meat before. Raise your hands. You've eaten goat meat before. Okay, well, that explains some things, but look at verse 30. But when this son of yours who has squandered your property with prostitutes comes home, you kill the fattened calf for him. Can you hear the anger in this young man? And then notice the dad. Notice in verse 31, he said this, why, you little brat. He didn't say that, did he? He said, my son. My son, the father said, you are always with me and everything I have is yours. But we had to celebrate and be glad because this brother of yours was dead and he's alive again. He was lost and is found. Character flaws. This young man was flawed in his spirit and in his character. And he had what were some of the flaws? Well, he had a sense of entitlement. He had a sense of entitlement. The brother falsely thought that his dad owed him something. He, like countless other people, missed the concept of unmerited grace. And watch this, folks, and I want you to get this morning. We need to get this morning. Understand that a sense of entitlement is one of the most dangerous things that can happen in the life of a Christian. And I've seen it happen many, many times over among church staff people and among all other Christian people. And first of all, let me ask you this. You don't have to answer this out loud. How many of you kind of sympathize with the older brother? How many of you kind of sympathize with him before we get too critical? What was he doing while everybody else was partying? He was out in the field working. You know, he was hoeing out there and he heard, came back in, he dropped his hoe, went inside, went back to the house. No one went out and got him. How would you feel? Well, nobody invited me. I guess I'm not welcome. Nobody went out and got him. He had been a good, obedient son. In verse 29 said, you never had a party for me. He never had a party for himself and his friends. Maybe he never asked for one. Maybe he never asked for a party. In verse 30, he said, this other brother of mine squandered your money. I didn't. I didn't go out and waste your money and squander it on prostitutes. He was, watch this, in verse 31, remember what we said, you are always with me and everything I have is yours. Go back into verse 12. The younger one, I'm still in Luke 15, the younger one said to his father, Father, give me my share of the estate. So he divided his property between them. Watch this. How much money did the dad have left? He didn't have any. The older brother got 2/3 and the younger brother got 1/3. And when it says there at the end of the passage, notice what it says in verse 31. My son, the father said, you are always with me and everything I have is yours. You have it. I don't have it anymore. I've given it away. I've given everything I have for you and for your brother. And so he's taken care of his father, hadn't he? You ever have that experience of an aged parent or grandparent sometime? You have to take care of them. And sometimes people say it's a financial hardship because they don't have any money. And I have to take care of him. Seems like a nice guy, doesn't he? The problem was this. This young man confused his responsibilities and his faithfulness to those responsibilities for giving him a sense of entitlement. What does entitlement mean? Webster's dictionary defines the word entitlement. The primary definition is this, quote, a right to benefits specified especially by law or by contract, close quote. You hear a lot about entitlements around election time. Have you noticed that? What are some entitlements we have in our country? Social Security, Medicare, Medicaid. Those are some of the things. And they're good. Entitlements are good when you work and you pay into those things. And the day comes when you're entitled to those, hence the words entitlement. How many of you would be interested in a Medicare supplement plan? I get calls. I'm not there yet. I'm getting close, but I've got a lot of leads if you need some supplement, because I get calls all the time or text or whatever. And so they're good when you've worked and you paid into those. They're bad when you haven't worked, however, and you haven't paid into those and you feel like, what? I'm entitled to this. A secondary definition, I like this one. This fits us, this point. A secondary definition of entitlement is, quote, a belief that one is deserving or entitled to certain privileges, close quote. That describes the older brother. He caused his father grief because he said, look at me, I'm entitled to these things. And watch this, those Jews back over in verses 1 and 2, they knew exactly who Jesus was talking about in that older brother. He didn't rejoice when his rebellious little brother came back. Those Jews weren't rejoicing when all of those tax collectors and, quote, sinners were coming to Jesus. Those very people that needed God were coming to him. And instead of rejoicing, they wanted to destroy Jesus out of jealousy. I'm coming back to that here in a moment. That's hypocrisy. In John chapter 8, Jesus said, then you will know the truth, and the truth shall set you free, right? And remember how the Jews responded? They said, quote, we are Abraham's descendants and have never been slaves of anyone. I guess they forgot about all that time in Egypt when they said, how can you say that we can be set free? Close quote. Jesus was talking about freedom from sin. But that was that entitlement. They had that entitlement. You can't do anything for us. We're above what you can provide for us. Everything in God's kingdom is just the opposite, isn't it, of the world? Or maybe you should say the world is, everything in the world is opposite of God's kingdom. Jesus told his disciples, whoever wants to be my disciple must deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me. For whoever wants to save his life will lose it, but whoever loses their life for me will find it. If anyone wants to, the Phillips translation, I like it, says this. If anyone wants to follow in my footsteps, he must give up all right to himself, take up his cross, and follow me. Now I'm going to ask you another question. What does God owe you today? What does God owe you today? And there are a lot of Christians, believe it or not, that would say, well, he owes me. I'm a preacher. I've been preaching now for 35 years. Haven't done it very well, but I've always tried to give my best. And I've always tried to prepare, and I've always tried to be there for a church wherever I'm serving. And so, you know, maybe I can bank that a little bit with the Lord. And the Lord looks down at me and says, you owe me everything. Sometimes worship leaders, sometimes deacons, sometimes small group leaders, you kind of feel a little bit entitled. Do you ever feel a little bit entitled? Well, wait just a minute, Pastor. Everybody listening, wait just a minute, Pastor. God has blessed me And I give a lot to the church. You know, I've had people threaten me with that. You know, I give a lot to the church. What do they think I'm going to do? Fall down on my knees? Oh, please, please, please don't. Folks, you may think God needs you and your money when he made it just fine before you were born. And after he calls you home to be with him, guess what? He's not going to say, well, that's it. Got to close up shop because I've called him. Listen, watch this. I give a lot of money to the church because God has blessed me and I've been very fortunate. And here's somebody over here that hasn't been blessed. They don't make very much money. They tithe just like I'm tithing. But I feel like I have a greater say in the church because of how much I give. It's called entitlement. And it does not please God at all. Well, I've taught Sunday school. I've taught small groups for decades. And so what I say in the church should carry more weight. The one voice that carries all the weight in our church should be the voice of Almighty God. That entitlement, it insults God. I read about a couple in England. They were going to get married. And, you know, things have changed so much. My wife's down in the nursery, by the way. She always tell everybody I'm not skipping church. But I've noticed she likes to volunteer for the nursery a lot. And so I guess 35 years of hearing me, she wants to serve. But when we had a wedding and we had a reception, you know, our reception was in the fellowship hall. And you know, we served everybody a piece of cake and some punch. And some of those little mints that you get at Dollar Tree or where, I don't know where they came from. But things have changed. And people were so nice to us and we gave us a lot of things. I think it was about 10 years ago before I used it. We had so many towels. I think I found a towel 10 years ago. My wife said, that was a wedding gift. And this couple said, we want cash. And so here's a Venmo account or whatever. And so just send us some money. And we'll purchase. We know what we need. Thank you, but you just send us money. And so they had the wedding. After the wedding was over, a lady got an email from them. And they said, we would like for you to increase your gift. And they said this, quote, we were surprised that your contribution didn't seem to match the warmth of your good wishes on our big day. If you want to send an adjustment, it will be thankfully received. Close. That's when you walk out of the room, take a deep breath before you type something back in and hit send. That sense of entitlement. We're owed this. You know what God owes us? He does owe us. He owes us. The Bible says, for the wages of sin is death. That's what God owes us. But the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. This young man had this crazy sense of entitlement, this older brother, and he also had this envy and jealousy that caused him to sin. Envy and jealousy, they're close cousins to entitlement, and envy and jealousy boiled up inside this young man and exploded right in the face of who? The dad. Envy and jealousy are close cousins to entitlement. They can be devastating in the life of a Christian. And again, there in verse 28, 29, don't you feel sorry for this dad? And by the way, he is so happy. He's so filled with joy and he's celebrating. And here comes his son to stick a knife in him again. Have you ever had that? Have you ever thought, said that? Can you let me enjoy one moment? This is one of the best moments of my life. And here comes the older brother with a sense of entitlement, enraged with envy and jealousy. And in verse 29, he answered his father, look, he snaps at him after he pleads with him. How much more can this dad humble himself? Jesus humbled himself all the way to the cross. and suffered the humility of the cross. And this dad pleads with this brother, and he snaps back at his father. My Bible says it has the word look with an exclamation point. The Greek word iduo is translated as look, and it sort of means this: listen, you. Has anybody ever said that to you? Listen, you. I like the Phillips translation here again. It says, then he burst out. Look how many years I've slaved for you. He burst out. Have you ever had a kid do that to you? Have you ever done that to one of your parents? Here was a young man. His heart wasn't right. He misinterpreted these fateful deeds for something that they were not. That didn't express genuine love for the father. Those Jews back in verses 1 and 2, they were obedient to all of these ceremonial laws. I mean, they were strict, weren't they? They strictly followed. Remember, they kept saying to Jesus, you know, you're not following all of these laws found in the Old Testament law code, the Mishnah, and in the Pentateuch and beyond that, things we've read into it. And their faithfulness was not a love for God, though, was it? Sometimes we can come to Sunday school and church. We come to small groups. We can come to church faithfully. We can play pickleball every Sunday night and be lost. Come on Wednesday night and be lost. How far back do you go to find envy and jealousy between siblings? Anybody know? How far back do you have to go? Can't go back any further, can you? The first person born naturally into this world was Cain, and he was a murderer. The human race got off to a bad start, didn't we? They brought their offerings to the Lord. Genesis 4:5 says, but on Cain and his offering, he did not look with favor. So Cain was very angry, and his face was downcast. Close quotes in Genesis 4:8, Cain lured his brother out into an open field, and what did he do? He killed him. Jealousy, envy. Joseph's brothers threw him into a pit. They dipped his coat in blood and said, a wild animal has killed Joseph. And they sold him into slavery. Why? They were jealous of him. They were envious of him. And it caused them to sin. That 10th commandment that says, thou shalt not covet, is actually a warning against envy and jealousy, isn't it? Exodus 20:17, I like the Old Living Bible. It says this: do not be envious of your neighbor's house. And it ends, or anything else he has. Don't be envious of it. This reluctant brother was filled with envy and jealousy, and he lashed out to hurt his father. Sometimes envy and jealousy just causes us to act like jerks. Sometimes we're jealous of somebody and we just act like jerks toward them. I read a story about a businessman, and this businessman hired two young men to be couriers there in his city. He had a lot of documents that he needed to be signed, that he needed to have signed, and so he hired these two young guys to be runners. And he would give them, he would fold up a document, stick it in a tube, and he would hand it to them, and he'd say, okay, you take it to so-and-so on the other side of town. And both the young men were doing a pretty good job. One day, a celebrity came to town. And this boss called these two young men, and he said, I've got a dream delivery for you, one of you. This celebrity's in town. I got a personal note. I know them, I'm going to send a message to them. And he said, let's see, I think I'll choose, well, you. And he gave him that message. So he got to go and meet this mega star. The other boy was so mad. I've worked just as hard as he's worked, if not harder. Why did he choose him over me? And he began to mope around And his workload kind of dropped off, and he just was angry at the world. And one day the boss came up with a plan, called the young guy in that he was mad, he was jealous, he called him in. He said, "I have another note for this celebrity. You get to take it this time." I said, "Oh, boy." And so he wrote something, he handed him the tube, and the guy went over and got to meet the celebrity, hand that to him or her. I don't know which one it was as I read the story. And when he read the note, it said this, quote, "I really didn't have anything else to say to you, but when you read this, smile and act pleased so that this young man can get his life back in order and stop acting like a jerk." Jealousy and envy are deadly in the life of a Christian. But aren't we so? The Father's love was not diminished, not one bit, for either one of these boys, was it? Pretty amazing. Could you say that? Could you say if my son or my daughter treated me like this, it wouldn't faze me at all? I don't know that we could say that. I've seen some parents that have lived that out. My mom and dad come to mind because of what we put them through, myself included too, as a rebellious teenager. What these boys did not make the Father love them any less or any more. There in verse 31, he says, the Father said, "Everything I have is yours. Come inside." You know, he pleaded with him, "Come inside." I just wonder if the older brother ever swallowed his pride and went inside. What do you think? If he just said, "You know what? I am still so mad, but Dad, because I love you, let's go inside and celebrate." I just wonder. I'm going to ask the Lord someday, "Lord, you didn't finish the story. Is that the end of it?" Did you know today, everybody listen, did you know today that you can't do anything in your life to make God love you any more than he loves you? Did you know that? "Well, I could be a missionary to a country somewhere and be out in the jungle, or I could be in, you know, in an Asian country where there are millions of people in a city and there, and surely God would love me more." He wouldn't love you anymore. He may call you to do that. Also this, aren't we glad? Everybody, there is nothing that you can do in your life to make God love you any less. Aren't we glad? But we can still break his heart. Remember the character in the prodigal son, the central figure is the father. And it broke his heart when his son rebelled against him. And I believe it breaks the heart of the father when we rebel against him. "Does he still feel the nails every time I fail?" I love that song. It's an older song. The little boy refused to eat his supper. You ever had that happen? You fix them something good to eat. And Patty has a niece that we thought she was going to turn into peanut butter. Because her mother would be eating somewhere. Patty's mother fixed this great meal and she'd look at it and say, "I want peanut butter." This little boy refused to eat his supper one night, and his dad looked at him and said, "Now you're going to eat your supper, I'm going to punish you." And the little boy said, "I'm not eating it." So he said, "Okay, here's what you do. You go to your room right now, go to bed early, no TV, no Bible story tonight, nothing. You go to bed. You go to bed hungry, go to bed right now." And the little boy went in his bedroom, and he cried. And the dad heard him crying. This is where you have to brace up, right, men? And he started to tell his wife, I can't do this. I got to go bring him back in here. And she said, "Aren't we glad wives keep us straight, men?" She said to her husband, "You can't do that. Now, you know if you do that, he's not going to listen to you anymore." And by the way, that's good advice, isn't it? When you tell your kid something, you follow through with it. And the little boy kept crying, and he kept crying, and the dad was in anguish. And finally, the dad looked at his wife and said, "You know what? I can't let him come out of there, but I'm going to go into where he is. And the next morning, the wife got up, and there was the dad in bed with the little boy, both of them sound asleep, the little boy cradled in his dad's arm, because the dad said, I can't bring him to where I am, but where I am, I'm gonna go to where he is. We sing that song, Heaven Came Down and Glory, what? Glory filled my soul. Jesus stepped out of heaven and came down to where we are so that we might be saved. He couldn't just bring us up to where he is apart from his death, burial, and resurrection. Is he Lord of your life today? Have you prayed? Have you asked Jesus to come into your heart and your life? Let's stand together. We're going to pray. Father, we thank you so much for your love, Father. Thank you so much, Father, today that we don't have to earn more favor with you, that you love us to the last degree, Father. You love us with a love that we can't comprehend. And God, we are so grateful today that there's nothing that we can do to make you love us more. But Father, we're so grateful that even though we sin and act foolishly and we're not obedient to you, you still love us the same. There's nothing we can do to make you love us any less. And God, for that, we are eternally grateful. But God, we know that we can, just like the father was grieved at his son's rebellion and at the older brother's hatefulness and bitterness, God, that we can grieve your heart today. Father, forgive us. Father, I pray if there's someone here this morning that's never accepted Jesus as his or her Lord and Savior, Father, I pray just as we said, today is the day, we sang that earlier, Father, that today would be the day when that person would come to accept Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. Father, maybe there's somebody watching on Facebook right from where they are. You've spoken to them. God, I pray that they would make a decision, that people hear, that people that are hearing the sound of my voice, whether in this room or are hearing it on a computer or on an electronic device, Father, that you would speak to hearts and people would make decisions right now. They'll be so glad they made someday when they stand before you in eternity, Father. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. And we're going to sing an invitation hymn, Brother Bob.
Have thine own way.
Have thine own way is our invitation hymn. You come as we sing this morning. Thank you so much for being here this morning. What we're going to do right now is we're going to take about a 3-minute break, 3 to 5 minute break. If you are a guest visiting with us this morning, we welcome you. You are welcome to stay for our business meeting time. If you prefer not to do that or you need to leave, you can feel free to do that now. If you need to get up and you need to go to the restroom or you just need to get up and walk around a little bit, we're going to take that break and then we're going to have our brief business meeting this morning. So we'll do that right now. Also, Facebook worshipers, thank you. God bless you. We're going to cut you loose right now. We pray that you have a wonderful week. Please let us know if there's anything we can do to help you know the Lord or help you know him better. God bless you. Have a great week. Okay, let's take a break for just a few minutes this morning.